Let's talk a little about Chinese landscape painting, which is the most respected subject in Chinese painting. Chinese landscapes are usually created by scholars, which means that the content of the picture is apt to be elite and to come from someone who has been highly educated. You can also easily guess that the approach that the scholar is going to be taking in terms of brushwork will be heavily influenced by calligraphy or by writing. Overall, there is a huge difference between East and West in terms of landscape traditions, and that, of course, is also going to include the relationship between humans and the natural world. In the detail at the bottom, which comes from figure 4.18 in our textbook by Fan Kuan's painting Travelers Amid Mountains and Streams, immediately I think you can pick up on some of those incredible differences. It's inevitable that there will be significant differences when artists are using different materials and different formats and fundamentally serving different needs with the creations that they make. In the East, in Chinese creations, we're working with ink and a brush and paper, often with paintings that are attached to a cloth backdrop. We also are working with very, very different formats. You can see some of them here, including the hanging scroll, which I'll show you a better picture of in a minute, and the horizontal scroll or the hand scroll, which is used in a bit more intimate way than the hanging scroll. And then we have also the extreme differences in terms of painting even on fans. The formats that will be most commonly observed by us will be these. Again, the hanging scroll, which is located over here. This is the hand scroll. And this is the album leaf. In this case, we have a double album leaf. And I have included for you a little summary borrowed from another textbook that explains the differences and reminds us of the different materials that are being used. The hanging scroll, right here, is going to be the closest to what we would experience in the West because these could be hung on walls for a viewing of subject matter and appreciation. But in contrast, the hand scroll, which we have over here, was meant to be looked at on a table. And you actually imagine yourself entering the landscape as you unroll the scroll and you mentally travel through the landscape. So it involves you, it brings you in, and it allows you to imagine that you were actually traveling through the land. Last is the album leaf, and we're going to see at least one of those when we look at Chinese painting. It's usually relatively small in scale and intimate, usually a single sheet, and it was intended for, I'm going to say, intimate viewing and perhaps contemplation as well. Using this landscape painting by Shen Zhou, let's take a look at his Poet on a Mountain. It is from the Ming Dynasty, and it is a pretty clear example where we can spot some of the elements of style that more or less consistently appear in Oriental landscapes. My main concern in talking about Chinese landscape or Oriental landscape in general is that you understand the principles of the style, perhaps less than I care about whether or not you know the specific names of the painters, although there are some pretty important painters that I would like you to know as well. But my goal is for you to be able to walk into any museum anywhere in the world, look at a painting that comes from the East, and be able to think about it clearly. So, what are these principles of style? The elements of Oriental landscape painting style include, number one, there's a tendency towards an asymmetrical balance. Nature does not seem to grow in a symmetrical way. At least my pine forest doesn't. By using asymmetry also, it suggests that the landscape is alive and growing and changing and organic in nature. Oriental painters also tend to give us empty spaces so that not every section of the painting has to be filled with something. These empty spaces often contribute to suggesting recession into the distance or perhaps the vastness of nature. Related to that, number three, humans are really small in scale, and in comparison with the grandeur of nature, human beings seem somewhat insignificant, being just a part of the landscape. Human beings, when you find them, never dominate the landscape, and in fact, sometimes you have to look really hard to actually find them. That takes us to number four, which is these landscape paintings tend to be conceptual. They are certainly not naturalistic. They are not imitations of nature. Instead, they convey the idea of nature. They might be based on a sketch that was made in nature or a visit to the landscape that is remembered, but they are generalized images. And they are images that are constructed by the artist to suggest the essence of nature. Consequently, they tend to be timeless images and universal images rather than specific places in time. Related to that, number five, the forms in an Oriental landscape painting tend to be simplified and may be conveyed through suggested forms. The artist is not attempting to capture surface reality. Instead, the artist is attempting to capture the ultimate essence and reality of the object. And the best way to do that is to generalize the depiction. So we end up with simplified and often suggested forms. These forms are also, number six, light and weightless. Even though in the painting that we have as an example, we have massive peaks, particularly in the distance, they don't look like they are weighty and solid and would come in weighing many, many tons. They seem to have a kind of mysterious instability to them. Overall, they tend to lack the concrete nature of Western landscape painting. Perhaps in part because number seven, the color is very subdued and value may be used to suggest depth in the composition. The darker the value, for example, the closer to the viewer often, not always, but often, the artist is attempting to suggest in his creation of a landscape painting. The purpose of paintings like this is for contemplation and meditation, and consequently, we want to keep the color subdued so that it is easy to focus on the underlying ideas. Color tends to excite the emotions. In this case, we're going with simply the values that one can find in ink in order to encourage contemplation and meditation. Because these pictures are created by scholars who have learned first to write using brush and ink before they learn to paint, we find number eight. The strokes are light and very quick, and they really suggest someone who knows how to handle a brush. And it clearly, in many of the brush strokes, suggests calligraphy, suggests Oriental writing. Number nine. The forms in the landscape are often old and weathered and worn by time. This suggests the passage of time, but it also suggests a continuation of time. And perhaps for us, the visitor, and again, if there are humans present, we're often kind of small, we are only a part of the adventure in nature that will endure long past our own very small in comparison lifespan. In other words, it's nature that's the grand and monumental subject, and it's nature that will continue long after our own lifetimes. As a part of that, the images themselves, the paintings, are continuous and they go off of the edge of the painting. In other words, they're not being framed or delimited essentially by the border of the painted image. So in our painting here, we're cutting off an edge of the mountain. The mountain itself continues beyond the painted image, just as nature will continue beyond our lifespan. One of the additional elements that is unique to Oriental imagery, in particular in the past, is that it is almost expected to combine words with pictures. And often spaces will be set aside specifically for the purpose of introducing, as in this painted image, a poem that you would read in conjunction with the picture. So a unification of writing and imagery. As a reality check, we can compare our Oriental landscape painting to an American landscape painting from the 19th century. Probably some of you recognize it as Asher B. Durand's Kindred Spirits. I would immediately suggest that the American piece is more concrete. There's a solidity to the forms, and there's a sense of weightiness that is a part of the desire of American painters to show their craftsmanship and to show a naturalistic object. I'd also like to suggest that in the American painting, the landscape painting, that nature has become a backdrop to the human characters, that the humans are really the most important part of that picture. Whereas in the Oriental landscape painting, we have the sense that nature is more important than the human, who is there perhaps even to contemplate and to appreciate the magnificence of the landscape. The American painting also not only looks more specific, as if you could go to someplace and find this, but it is much more highly detailed, even in the background of the composition, as opposed to the suggested forms and the empty spaces that we find in paintings often coming from the East. The American painting, I have the feeling, when I look at it anyway, that I'm really not invited in, that it isn't for me to experience the landscape. It's for the two men who are in the picture to experience the landscape. In Oriental paintings, the viewer is often invited in, and the reason for that is the viewer has the opportunity to contemplate the meaning of the picture. And in order to do that, the viewer has to imagine entering that picture. And in the case of the landscape painting we've been looking at, I think there is a diagonal line that leads out into the space of the viewer that does suggest that maybe we could go in and perhaps wander through the landscape and appreciate the splendors of the landscape, just like the very small figure on the top of the mountain.